The webinar, Insights on Geriatric Wellness During Pandemic, is to commence shortly. I request all the participants to keep their microphones on mute.
Karen, shall we start?
Yes, sir, we're starting. Advances in medicine and healthcare have led to an increase in the life expectancy over the last century. Individuals in the geriatric age group comprises a significant proportion of the population. Their special needs present a greater problem against the backdrop of COVID pandemic. Though the COVID-19 virus affects all age groups, it is more prone to produce severe illness in the elderly, who in addition may have various other comorbidities. Health professionals and family members must be sensitized to the special needs of the elderly. Their management requires a holistic approach. Herein lies the importance of this webinar, Insights on Geriatric Wellness During Pandemic, organized by the Department of Community Science of the College of Horticulture, Kerala Agriculture University. May I now welcome Dr. C. Narayanakutty, the Associate Dean, College of Horticulture, Kerala Agriculture University, whose wholehearted support and encouragement have guided us in planning this program, for the welcome address. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Good morning to all of you. Honorable Vice Chancellor of the University, Dr. R. Chandra Babu, eminent speakers of today's webinar, faculty members, and other fellow participants. The COVID-19 pandemic has changed the way the world was. Today, we are encouraging our elderly citizens to self-isolate and to protect themselves from getting infected. During times of isolation and quarantine, older people need safe access to nutritious food, basic supplies, money, medicine to support their physical health and boost their immunity levels. Dissemination of accurate information is also crucial to ensure that the elderly people get clear messages on how to stay healthy, both physically and mentally, during the pandemic period. Hence, today's webinar on Insights on Geriatric Wellness During Pandemic, organized by the Department of Community Science, College of Horticulture, Vellanikkara, assures greater significance in the current scenario. It is my privilege to welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. R. Chandra Babu, for the inauguration of this function, whose valuable guidance is always with us in all our endeavors. I cordially welcome you, sir, to this webinar. We have with us today an eminent panel of speakers comprising of a nutritional expert, a palliative care expert, and a dietitian to speak about geriatric wellness. I take this opportunity to welcome each one of you to this webinar. First of all, let me extend a warm welcome to Dr. Umesh Kapil, who is former professor and a professor of the Department of Gastroenterology and Human Nutrition Unit of the AIIMS New Delhi, who will be delivering the keynote address today. Hearty welcome to you, sir. Now let me welcome Dr. Suresh Kumar, director of the WHO Collaborating Center for Community Participation in Palliative Care, who will be speaking on challenges to geriatric wellness during pandemic in this webinar. We have also with us Dr. Dharani Krishnam, former president of the Indian Dietetic Association, who will be delivering a talk on geriatric diet. Hearty welcome to both of you, and we look forward to hear from both of you. Finally, I welcome all the participants who have joined in this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now invite our most respected and beloved Vice Chancellor, Kerala Agricultural University, Dr. R. Chandra Babu, the cornerstone of all the achievements of Kerala Agricultural University and the guiding force in organizing this event, for the inaugural address. Sir, we welcome you.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Respected experts, Dr. Umesh Kapil, Professor Epidemiology, AIIMS, New Delhi, Dr. Suresh Kumar, Director, WHO Collaborating Center for Community Participation in Palliative Care, Dr. Dharani Krishnan, former President of Indian Dietetic Association, Dr. Narayanaguti, Associate Dean College of Horticulture, Dr. Sija Thamachan, Head Department of Community Science, my fellow faculties in the Department of Community Science, Dr. Anina, Dr. Sharan, Dr. Lakshmi, and my dear faculty from Kerala Agricultural University, other participants. Very good morning to all of you. I'm very happy that Department of Community Science is taking very novel initiatives during this pandemic so that we can be of service to the society. Recently, they have taken two initiatives which I want to inform the participants as well as the respected experts. We have considerable number of underweight children in our state, of course, relatively lower compared to other states across the country. But still, we want to see that no children in our state is underweight. So our community science faculty prepared energy dense nutri bars and distributed to all our Anganwadis throughout our 14 districts in our state through the Department of Women and Child Development during this pandemic. And it was well received by the policy makers, and they want Kerala Agricultural University to scale up its production. And our Honorable Minister for Agriculture even asked us to commercialize this energy dense Nutribar, because such is the positive impact of this Nutribar on the health of the children. Second initiative the Community Science Department faculty took is that to have established a Nutri Garden in all the more than 35,000 Anganwadis across the 14 districts in the state of Kerala, again joining hands with the Department of Women and Child Development. These two initiatives, I am sure, will go a long way in improving the nutrition and health of our children, who are the future human capital of the country. Other extreme of the age group, the elders, or what we call the senior citizens, they are all the more important. They have vast experience about the life, but because of their declining innate immunity and fragile, I will say other mental pressures and whatever other experience they had in their family life, they are, I think, both psychologically as well as health, they are actually fragile. They are not weak. They are the very resilient people among our community. But they need all the more care, as we care for our infants and young children. The senior citizens need all the more care. And of course, during this pandemic, their vulnerability we witnessed. To start with, I think Italy, we witnessed what happened to the senior citizens due to this pandemic in the Italy and European countries. In at least Washington State in US, the pandemic first actually noticed in the senior care homes. So that's how actually the world, they are more vulnerable. And I want to actually share, of course, I don't want to know, one of my our colleague who are recently working with Kerala Agricultural University lost his both parents over a period of 20 days for this pandemic. It is really unfortunate. And in spite of all the care and medication, what we were recently talking about, he could not actually save the, his both the parents, and it is a colossal loss for him, both psychologically and family wise. So this intervention, this knowledge creation or awareness or dissemination about geriatric wellness is all the more important. And I also want to show you, of course, this is not something like a canvassing or something, just I want to share. I hope people can witness this book. This is one of my professors, senior professors who retired. He wrote this just 6 months back and published for the benefit of colleagues and friends. And this is what it is. Title goes as Bodhi Marathadil. We know the Gautama Buddha got his wisdom. That's what the literature says. He got the wisdom under the tree, like Isaac Newton discovered the theory of relativity. And he, out of 25 chapters he gives for the senior citizen, out of that 17 is about their food and health, how to maintain or improve their innate immunity and health during their age, in the growing age. So this is a very important topic. I thank all the three experts who actually shared their valuable time and also came forward in sharing their experience towards this important knowledge initiative or knowledge awareness creation among the elderly and other people in the family who are taking care of the elderly, and also the faculty, as well as the associate in horticulture and my fellow colleagues in the community science department of Kerala Agriculture University. Thanks for this initiative. I appreciate, and I am very happy to inaugurate this webinar, and I also will be listening to the experts for their valuable advice. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Today, we are honored with the presence of an eminent epidemiologist and the former professor and head, Department of Gastroenterology and Nutrition at the prestigious Institute of All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. He is the author of 300 plus publications in indexed journal and a contributor to close to 20 textbooks. He has been a consultant of UNICEF and WHO in various projects. He is also the recipient of B.C. Srivastava ICMR National Award in the year 1992 and has also received various other national awards. We wholeheartedly welcome Dr. Umesh Kapil to address the gathering. Sir, can you please unmute yourself?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Respected Vice Chancellor, Mr. Chandra Babu, Associate Dean, Head of the Department, Dr. Sija, it's a proud privilege to be associated with the webinar. And within the next 30 minutes, I'll try to make a complete profile of the nutritional status. Plus, I'll try to make some way forward, what can be done about it. May I have the next slide, please? Now, if you look at the country as such, we have about 8% of the population who are 60 years and above. And if we take the total population of about 1400, so we do have about 130 million population in the geriatric group. Next. Now, are the geriatric population or nutritionally vulnerable with or without pandemic? Yes, they are. Our elderly are nutritionally vulnerable, and I'll just in the next few slides I'll tell you what is the scientific evidence which we have from our country. Next. Now, there are many factors which affects the nutritional status of elderly. And one of the most important is unemployment and low, which brings low finances. Now, very few percent of our elderly are employed in the organized sector, which provides them pension. So hence what happens, they are unemployed, they have low finances. Also what they have is, once the finances are less, then their purchasing power to buy food becomes reduced. And also because of the chronic diseases and inflammation due to chronic diseases present in them, that reduces the absorption of the nutrients, and which leads to further addition to their undernutrition and malnutrition. They do have chronic illnesses. They do have loss of appetite and loss of taste. They have, we have done a recent survey, we found that loss of appetite is another important issue with them, why they don't eat sufficient food. But the most important factor in the recent survey which we conducted is oral health. Next. Now, if you look at the total population, this is an ICMR-sponsored study, and out of 1,000 geriatric population, as high as 345, they had a chewing problem. Now, this is something important. Now, once you cannot chew a food, you, by self-selection, you try to take only foods which you can chew and gulp in. Now, this is something which people don't realize it, but the elderly, they do have an important problem of oral health, the chewing problem. As high as 233 had a loss of appetite. Now, this is something important. And also what we found, that about 188, they had the issue of constipation. Constipation is not a symptom, it is a disease. Now, all these factors lead to poor intake or inadequate intake of nutrition by these elderly. And apart from the diseases which they have, like chronic smoking leading to chronic cough, and also they have urinary incontinence, fecal incontinence, general fatigue. These are the common problems. We are talking about a committee-based study which we recently completed in 2018. Next. Now, the common diseases which they have, like if you look at the our country, about 8 to 10% of the population per se, general population, they have diabetes. And if we go to the senior age group, almost 25% they have diabetes, they have hypertension. Now, these are the diseases which leads to, a doctor advises them, even their neighbor advises them, that you restrict your dietary intake. Again, I come back to an important issue of constipation, which is an important, because people don't eat. They feel that if we eat half a kg of cereals, so we should pass out at least 300 grams. And if they don't pass out, then they feel uncomfortable throughout the day. This is something which we need to take care of our elderly people. Next. Now, I would like to state here that we should not look at nutrition in isolation. Nutrition is not just food. It's not just food. If you look at the all over the world, nutrition is a combined outcome of development in different sectors in the country. So what happens, even if you look at the Poshan Abhiyan which we have participation of health, nutrition, rural development, transport, water supply and sanitation, Ministry of Agriculture. Unless until all these sectors which are mutually supportive and complementary role in deciding the nutritional status do not work together, will not be able to have the nutritional status of our population. And same is true for the under 5 children, that all these sectors have to combine together. And I must say that nutrition is one of the indicator of development of society or a country or a state. It is not something, the availability of the food, availability of different types and varieties of food. Next. Now, what is the existing evidence on geriatric nutrition? Unfortunately, we do not have many studies. And National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau, which is a part of ICMR, they conduct routine surveys, and they published a report which was of 10 states in the country. And they talk about diet and nutritional status of the elderly. I would like to share, after that we don't have any much recent data. We do have some isolated studies which talks about the nutritional status. Next. Now, if you look at this, so these states which included in the survey were Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Karnataka, Odisha, West Bengal, Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh. And they have a very sound scientific sampling procedure. They go to 120 villages, and then each village they take 20 households, and so on and so forth. So they have conducted this study. I'll present some findings of that. Next. Now, if you look at the this, these are the different caloric intake of what you call the consumption of food. This is old data, I must admit. There must be some data is not available, except for the isolated studies. You find that only 10% of the subjects had caloric intake between 90 to 100%. And if you add to this, about 74%, 10 plus 64, about 74-75% were having adequate calories. And then if that means that about 25% of the subjects, they do not consume calorie which is as per their recommended dietary allowances. And same is true from protein, thiamine, niacin and others. Next. Now, another important parameter which we normally study in a community-based study is that we calculate the BMI, which is a ratio of height and weight, and it indicates less than 16 third degree of chronic energy malnutrition, 16 to 17 to 18.5. less than 18.5 is indicates the first degree of chronic energy malnutrition among the subject. If we don't eat, so we don't have a proper weight, this is being indicated by the BMI. Next. Now, if you look at the pool data of these 10 states, as far as 54% of the subjects who were surveyed had chronic energy deficiency. Now, this is something very important, that 54% in the males, 50% in females, they were suffering from chronic energy deficiency. Next. Now, even if you look at the caste-wise, amongst the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, OBCs and other castes, SC had almost 64% of the subjects, or 65% of the subjects, they were having BMI or chronic energy deficiency less than 18.5. Next. Like we, as I mentioned to you, we recently completed a study in 2018 and we published it. And what we found, about 27% of the subjects, they were suffering from chronic energy deficiency. We did find subjects who were overweight and obese. So it was 18% were overweight and about 5% were obese. Now this is something important, that even in the elderly age group, we have a double burden of malnutrition, they're obese as well as undernourished. Next. Now another study from Tamil Nadu, they found that about 94% of the subjects were consuming a nutrient which was less than recommended dietary allowances. Next. Now, another study documented that as high as 18% were subjects were undernourished and 59% were at risk of malnutrition. This is essentially from the rural areas. Next. Now, again, which is very interesting, when we went for the community-based survey, and what we found that at least 10% of the subjects who were consuming the alcohol regularly. Now, this was eye-opener for us, that old people, genetic people consuming alcohol is about 10%, which is a large chunk of people. Next. Now, similarly, another study from Haryana, we found that about 16% of men, 1% of women were regular consumption of alcohol while smoking, for 77% of the men, and just remember this, 46% of the women were also smoking. Now, this is a high number, and this is what leads to chronic bronchitis and asthmatic issues. Next. Now, we must remember that ultimately it's the finances which decides the type of food you are purchasing. Now, most of the, as I mentioned earlier, most of these elderlies are employed in the informal sector as a casual worker or self-employed in low-skilled or unskilled occupation, which is again brings them less money. Next. Now, most of these people, elderly people, they have a fear of dying alone. And the more it is with the women who become a widow, and they have a much more risk of insecure environment in their own families. Next. Now, if you look at the urban, they have low income, they are in poor physical condition, poor housing, high rate of unemployment or underemployment, there's a lack of affordable healthcare services, and they are more prone to have crime. They go for alcoholism, they go for mental illness. This mental illness is another issue which I'll talk about it, for which WHO is highly concerned. Next. Now, I'll come down to the main topic. What is the impact of the current COVID pandemic on elderly population? Now, because of the lockdown which we have for almost 3 months, 3.5 months, there's a stoppage of all cottage industries, so there was a increase in unemployment leading to poor finances, poor purchasing power of these elderlies, inadequate food procurement and consumption, lack of transport facilities to health centers, lack of treatment facilities for their chronic diseases. And what has been observed that because of the mass media, the elderly were often quarantined or locked down in their houses because they were vulnerable. It was propagated on the mass media, which was true also. But what was happening that they were being socially isolated, which is a very dangerous thing, that you socially boycott or socially isolate these elderly. Next. Now, what has been observed in some, I must say, not in published scientific literature, but in the mass media, that there has been increase in smoking, increase in alcohol intake. There are issues of undereating and overeating. Obviously, because of the lockdown, there was decrease in physical activities, increase in social isolation. And there have been a large number of cases have been reported about abuse. Now, this abuse is essentially physical or mental or social or financial. But this has been an important issue, which have been people, these NGOs have been receiving calls that this is what is happening. Now, also what we are finding that because of the new nuclear families which are being practiced, the traditional family-based care for the elderly is gradually minimizing. Next. Now, elderly are, because of the low income, they're purchasing the poor nutrition quality food because the cost of foods rich in micronutrients like fruit, vegetables, they cannot afford, and the consumption is reduced, and their specific micronutrient deficiencies are not there. Next. Now, you can have a look at some of these. These are the victims of undernutrition, and these are the victims of overnutrition. Next. Now, Dr. Vice Chancellor Sir mentioned about the immunity. That is true, that if we have a poor purchasing power, we are buying low nutrition quality food, consuming inadequate food, we have a decreased immune function, there's an increased vulnerability to COVID, morbidity, and higher mortality. Next. Now, we quite commonly, it has been seen that the elderly people who are obese, they suffer from corona and their mortality is high. Again, because of the decreased immunity, multiple associated comorbidities, once you're 60, 70 plus, the chances of diabetes is as high as 40%, hypertension is 40%, chronic kidney disease, because of the chronic smoking, you have the pulmonary diseases. And what has been documented is a normal weight person takes about 10 days to recover, while obese take 20 to 30 days to recover. Next. Now, what happens to the obese people? We have limited data that obese people cannot do lung exercise properly. That's number one. Number two, they have less chest movement, which increases the COVID problem. Their breathing is shallow. The clearance of the inhaled particles like viruses and others, that is poor. And hence, what has been seen that in obese, because of immune factor and other pathophysiological factors, their venous thrombosis in their lungs is high. Next. Now, as I mentioned to you, the physical abuse, mental abuse, these are the very important issues. And WHO has been mentioning that health anxiety, depression, chronic stress, insomnia, this domestic violence is also very common, has become very common during the lockdown period, because the families were staying together, they were locked down, it was difficult for them. So the call to the NGOs have been in increasing number because of COVID. Next. Now, I couldn't find many studies, but this is a study which has been published in August 2020 in the International Journal of Geriatric Psychiatry, and they found that social isolation and loneliness is significantly increased the morbidity and mortality amongst the geriatric population. Next. Now, what is the status of COVID and mortality amongst elderly? Next. Now, if you look at the deaths, 60 to 74%, this is again the mass media newspaper reports which I have been quoting over here, that 60 to 70 out of total deaths, 39% were in 60 to 74 years, and above 75 years, 14% of the deaths. This is a large number, and again because of multiple factors, it's not one factor, only nutrition. They have diabetes, hypertension, CKD, pulmonary disease, poor immunity. All these factors jointly, they are leading to more vulnerability of these subjects. Next. Again, if you look at, as the age increases, the death rate amongst the elderly group increases. Next. Now, I'll just take 2-3 minutes more. What is the government effort? It's not that the government is sitting silent. They are making an extra effort. Next. Now, they have issued specific guidelines and instructions for senior citizens above 60 years that they have a higher risk of severe illness from coronavirus. And they talk about spend more time to them, regularly monitor them, do not allow visitors in home, don't shake hands, and so on and so forth. So there are guidelines and government efforts. Unfortunately, only 10% of the population can read this English advertisement. But yes, it is also being done in the vernacular languages. Next. Now, government is providing free distribution of 5 kg of food, basically it's a cereals per person, and 1 kg of pulses per household. This is under the government scheme. It's a large population which we have, 5 kg of cereals and 1 kg of pulses per household. And this is in addition to the 5 kg of wheat and cereals which are being provided per month to each person, and this is about the cost of about 3 to 4 rupees a kg. This is being provided. Next. Now, I must say that entire presentation which I have made has a limitation. No research studies have been published on nutritional status of elderly during COVID pandemic. If you ask me, Government of India, ICMR, DST, DBT have not sanctioned any community-based project during the last 6 months. And all the presentation and the data which I have made is based on scientific experts' opinion and mass media reports. Next. Yeah, so I would like to conclude my presentation by mentioning that its elderly are more prone to lack of employment, lack of less purchasing power, less food consumption, poor immunity, coexistence of chronic diseases, makes them more vulnerable to infections. The lack of healthcare facilities, the distance, transport is a very important issue. Even if you go to the rural areas, the distance of a health center is about 5 to 10 kilometers from their home. It's very difficult to have transport because everything was locked down. And otherwise also non-pandemic time also, they have a problem of walking, they have joint pains, and above all, they have the issue of social isolation. And all these factors combined are making our elderly nutritionally vulnerable. Next. With these few small presentation, I thank again Vice Chancellor Sir, Associate Dean, and Dr. Sija for giving me this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your words of wisdom. The participants may now post their queries and comments in the chat box. Participants, you're welcome to post your comments in the chat box. Sir, here's a question by Nivya EM. Is there any correlation between nicotine usage and COVID-19?
Well, honestly, we do not have much scientific evidence. Whatever, COVID is just a 6 months old disease, and we don't have any experience. Whatever has been there is basically all wisdom of the treating physicians, what they're finding it out. So when we talk about COVID and nicotine, COVID and blood pressure, COVID and diabetes, it is all conjectures. They're all associations. We don't have any scientific evidence. And we are there's an evolution in the process. Initially, we thought that's the fomites which are responsible. Now they say it's a airborne transmission is more important. They talk about, earlier it was said mask should not be worn. Now they say mask is most important. So nothing can be said based on the scientific evidence. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Here's another question. Why mental disorders are more seen in women compared to men?
This is a very, very, very important question. And why women have mental disorders? Because there are two or three important parameters which happens. Number one, the percentage of women during the elderly population is much more high, because two things, because they are widow, okay, they don't have any financial support, and also there is no status which is being given to them in the family. So there are many other factors, but it has been seen that yes, women have more mental disorders as compared to men. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Another question. What is the impact of COVID on old age people who consume alcohol on daily basis?
Again, as I mentioned to you, that we don't have much evidence. But remember one thing, that alcohol per se, it suppresses all the body physiology. That's for sure. That is the existing scientific evidence. If a person takes alcohol, it suppresses all the body physiological functions, which includes immunity and everything. So it is presumed that it has been said that it might be these alcoholic people would have more morbidity and mortality due to COVID. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Tejaswi Bharati. Whether elderly people can take multivitamin tablets daily to prevent COVID?
Well, one thing we must remember for everybody, not even for elderly, everybody. God has made us to eat food, and the food comes from the crops. And food provides us everything, all multiple micronutrients, vitamins, minerals, carbohydrate, protein, and everything provides the food. So I think so, if we can afford it, we should take the multiple variety of foods which are available. Don't depend upon the tablets and pills, which is not desirable. God has made us to eat food, not pills. But yes, if the doctor prescribes us that yes, you may take this particular multivitamin, yes, as an individual basis, these can be taken. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Deepa Thomas. Do mental and neuro problems increase during COVID pandemic period, especially in the old age people?
Yes, definitely. It has been, again, the reports which have come into the print media, that there has been an increase. In fact, a study which I put down in published in August 2020, that there has been an increase in the mental health issues among the elderly, and which is leading to increase morbidity and mortality amongst the elderly people. Yes, that's true. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Binu. How COVID-19 influence children with health issues, minor and major issues?
Well, if you take the age group wise, the morbidity and mortality both are much less in compared to young children, young population, you can call it below 20 years, is rather rare. They have the disease, they have it like a common cold cough, and it passes off. So I would not like to say that yes, there would be morbidity, but the major issue in the COVID is the mortality and its complications of COVID. So younger population is perfectly safe, and anything which happens to them is comfortable. We can go ahead with it. No issues, no special provisions are required. Using the mask, taking care routine, preventive measures are important. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A question by Krishnasri Arun. Sir, how can we deal with the low bioavailability of nutrients among geriatric population?
Well, I must say that the Indian diet is the best in the world. And whatever we make, say rice, dal, what you have, tambar dal, or whatever we call it, you have dosa and the idli and all vada. So there's always, our diet is essentially a combination of cereals and pulses, plus vegetables, plus seasonal fruits. They are the complete package of a balanced diet. So if you take, and the seasonal fruits are important. So if you take these things, we would be comfortable. All the micronutrient deficiencies will not be there. And just remember that green leafy vegetables are a good source of all minerals and vitamins, which we tend to ignore it, thinking that it is like a fodder being given to the cattle. So please, we must promote the consumption of green leafy vegetables to prevent these micronutrient deficiencies. Thank you.
Another question by Rajisha. Is there any chance for geriatric people with depression to show resiliency towards COVID?
It's a very difficult question, honestly. I'll not be able to answer this. My apologies. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A question by Nivya. Can COVID-19 virus be transmitted through drinking water?
What has been said that not the drinking water per se, what has been documented is that the fomites are basically objects which are infected or contaminated with virus. So if a virus is being, if a person has consumed a glass of water, same glass, if being consumed by another person, so there's a high probability of transmission of virus. Okay, like we have initially we said that clean your handles, car doors, lift buttons. Okay, so these are the precautions. They were considered as a fomites, and it was presumed that these fomites can transmit the viral infection. Thank you.
A question by Shruti. We are advised to take vitamin C supplements, but vitamin C tablets usually come in higher dose than RDA. So is there any ill effects?
Well, what has been in earlier studies about 40, 50 years back, it was thought that the high doses of vitamin C, 500 milligram every day for a period of 6 weeks, 8 weeks, would boost the immunity. It was there. But now we don't recommend the vitamin C because the group which was again a randomized controlled trial was conducted. Those people who were given high dose of vitamin C, they ultimately had more renal stones, right? So by and large, what we must do, if you want to take vitamin C, take lime, take simple. Why want to go to synthetic vitamins and minerals? Just remember that God has made our body in such a manner, you eat as much as possible. Body will absorb according to their need. Rest would be shunted out. If you take these pills, it might be absorbed more. So absorption is always limited in a physiological amount from the food what we eat. Minerals and vitamins, we cannot be sure about. People have discussed about vitamin A being given 500,000 international unit and children getting killed. Okay, so there's much more absorption from the synthetic as compared to normal food which we consume. Thank you.
A question by Amalu Suresh. What are the natural methods to prevent the attack of coronavirus?
Well, what has been said in the allopathic medicine is that you wear mask, right? Second is you maintain the distance, social distance, and third is hand washing. These are the three natural methods, you may call it, to prevent this viral infection. This is the best way. This is a possibly globally it has been talked about, but yes, in the Ayurveda they have been talking about tablets to increase the immunity. There are different medicines which have been there to improve the immunity, but by and large the allopathic medicine talks about these three important interventions.
Question by Simla Thomas. Whether intake of turmeric on daily basis will improve the immunity or will it cause any side effects?
Well, turmeric has been used in our country for ages together. And what has been seen that turmeric, in fact, the studies conducted by National Institute of Nutrition have documented scientifically that turmeric has a role, has an anti-cancer property. It boosted the immunity. So Well, there is a evidence that turmeric has a role in improving the immunity, but a small amount can be definitely been taken, and whether it will prevent the COVID, we do not know. There is no scientific evidence on that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think by now we had a good round of discussion, and thank you all for your active participation. I once again thank Dr. Umesh Kapil for enlightening us. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure interacting with all of you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Now we are moving on to the next presentation. And may I now invite Dr. Suresh Kumar, a pioneer in the field of community-based and volunteer-driven palliative care. He's presently the director of WHO Collaborating Center for Community Participation in Palliative Care. His model of palliative care has found acceptance beyond our borders in Thailand, Indonesia, and Sri Lanka. On behalf of Kerala Agriculture University, I invite you, sir, to share your thoughts.
Good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
It's a, will you be able to present the slides from your side? I think that would be better.
Yes.
I sent it to Seja yesterday, Dr. Seja.
Yes, sir. Dr. Seja will be doing that.
Okay. Yeah, let me start. Let's start with the first slide. Because what I'm trying to cover in the next 30 minutes is very much in line with what my previous speaker, Dr. Umesh, has done. Actually, it's more like the follow-up of what he has already done. So this is basically about COVID-19, what are the challenges to disease wellness. And I'm looking at that, two components. First part, I'm looking at what are the issues in geriatric wellness even without COVID-19. And then the second part, I'll be looking at what are the challenges, new challenges related to COVID-19. Can I have the first slide, please? So this is a graph. You can see that the x-axis actually is actually years, 18, up to 2010, and the y-axis as years life expectancy. You can see that when you look at it, this is global data. When you look at it, you can see that. Average life expectancy up to 1750 was below 40, and after 1750 around 1800, you look at the x-axis, it started going up, and then it goes steadily up exponentially, and now it's around more than 80-85, and they say that there is no upper limit. It will reach life expectancy at birth will reach 100 at the age of in 2060. Basically, what this shows is that people tend to live longer. People, our generation tend to live longer than our previous generation, and our future generation will tend to live longer than us. So this is basically, at the first look, this may look good because you are living much longer than people who lived in the past. But there are some other issues related to it. Can I have the second next slide, please? Yeah, so the implication is that there will be more and more elderly people in the community, particularly since the people live longer, and also the fertility rates have come down, which means that even now, 1/4 of the population of the developed world and 1/10 of the developing world is above 60. And they say that in 25 years, 25% of world population is expected to cross 60. So this will be more and more elderly people in the community. More and more elderly people in the community means it has a lot of implications, lot of social implication, lot of financial implication, economic implication. It will affect everything. Yeah, next one, please. Yeah, so if you list the issues, because elderly are not you tend to live longer, but that does not mean that you tend to live longer comfortably. There are a lot of issues related to comfort and well-being of the elderly. If you broadly classify, you can classify them as physical problems, economic problems, social problems. emotional issues and what we can be called spiritual issues. I'll just cover these briefly. Next one, please. Next slide, please. Yeah. So physical problems or old age, there are multiple issues. Age-related changes in the body and increased physical vulnerability, more of chronic disease, more of disabilities, and also like diminishing reserve. Like we usually people, adults and non-elderly young people, they have a lot of reserve. Like when, for example, when you can say that you walk, you breathe comfortably, and you run over a short distance also you breathe comfortably, but when you run on a longer distance you start having what we call increased respiratory rate, because you have a respiratory reserve, you're breaking into the respiratory, so you take more and more effort. But the elderly, what happens, this is true of all the organs, the liver, your renal system, your heart, your respiratory system, it has a reserve. And we are not utilizing the full reserve when we do normal activities. What happens in the elderly is that the reserve comes down, which means you are not able to function, like your functional capacity also comes down. And then multiple diseases due to aging and degeneration is also there. This all contribute to physical problems of the elderly. Next one, please. Lot of psychobehavioral problems when you get old. Emotional problems, it has been documented, well documented, that emotional problems are higher in the elderly. Dementia, multiple various type of dementia happen. And so this is very common. Depression is quite high among elderly. Feeling of worthlessness is also quite high. Next one, please. Yeah. And then social loss of income. And I'll come to that, particularly in situation like India and particularly in the what we call low and middle income countries. Lots of income is a major issue. Medical grow, because when you get older, you have more treatment, like more diseases, more illness, more hospitalization. And then there's a skewing effect in allocation of resources, both from the part of the state and also from the part of the family very often. Because if you have only limited resources, you tend to spend major portion on the younger population, because they are the economic, they bring income to the family, they are more productive than the elderly people. So this happens. Mm-hmm. At the state level also, like the resources are allocated more in favor of younger people. Then fairly when you get older, the chances of your partner dying is quite high. So widowhood is also a common problem. Loneliness, people feel lonely, and also along with that you have actual neglect and abuse. Next one. Spiritual issues, what we call it, can be religious issues and it can be non-religious also. It is something to do with meaning of life. You start to reflect on your life. What have you done? What have you achieved anything in your life? Many things you have been pursuing earlier aggressively now look meaningless. And so this is, and also there is an issue of coping with losses. You lose your partners, you lose your old classmates, you lose your friends, people die. And so this is also then you also start thinking more about death and more about what happens after death. And next one. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a summary. Like when you get older, you are more prone for infections because your immunity level goes down. You are more prone for injuries because more vulnerable, falls and fractures are more common. You need more assistance when you get older. And you are more prone for psychological problems. This has been proven. And you are more prone for degenerative diseases, arthritis, hearing defects, dementia. You are more prone for various diseases. You are more prone for disability. And you have a higher risk of dying because an older person has a much higher risk of dying than a younger person. Yeah. Next one, please. When the society side, it's a big challenge. Well-being of the geriatric population is complex and it's very challenging. Multiple problems can coexist, like as we mentioned earlier. Diseases present as atypical. Many of the diseases like pneumonia or some of the infections, some of the cancers, the presentation in the elderly is different. And the functional decline, you are not able to do what the person is not able to do what he or she was used to do in the past. And then there is a problem with food intake, that when you get older, generally you tend to lose appetite and you also have feeding problems. Mood changes are common. dementia, we mentioned the common. Social isolation and withdrawal is very common. And there are also financial issues related to the well-being of the elderly. Please, next one. Next slide, please. Yeah. When you look at the Indian situation, they say that in 2016 census, like the study showed that the 12 crore, 120 million elderly in India. And this is the second largest elderly population in the world. That's mainly because we are the second largest population in the world. 80% of the elderly in India are in rural areas. Then the next point is very important. 40% of our elderly are below poverty line. They don't have enough money to survive. And over 73% of elderly in India are illiterate. Has a lot of implication when you, for example, in situations like COVID, when you send messages, like the sensitization programs and all. And 55% of women of 50 years and 60 years and above are widows. They had lost their partners. And about 90% of older people have no official social security, no provident fund, no gratuity, no pension. So there is a lot of issues for elderly in India. I have also one slide on Kerala because I'm talking from Kerala. 15% of the population, Kerala is aging, the society in Kerala is aging much faster than rest of India. And with the rest of India, this is around 11%, but Kerala, this is already 15% of the population is elderly. 20% of the population will be above 65 by 2025. High percentage of widows as rest of India. And what we call decreasing supporting manpower, in the past, like for every elderly person, there is to have around 10 or 11 people to support, in theory. This may be children, grandchildren, other relatives, but this is called potential support ratio, PSR. And they have noticed that all over the world, the potential support ratio is coming down. Not many people around, mainly in, for example, Indian situation or in Kerala situation, families becoming nuclear, and also youth migrating out for jobs. So you don't have a lot of manpower. When you're old, you don't have a lot of people to support you. That's also a factor. Then socioeconomic and cultural factors are there. And then Kerala is the state with the highest number of old age homes. So more and more people are depending on other institutions other than family for support. So this is the situation in Kerala. Next one, please. Yeah. Now, with this new pandemic, there are some specific issues related to this well-being of the elderly. The first one is the vulnerability of the population. This has already been covered by my previous speaker. This group of people have a higher risk of serious illness and death if infected. An elderly person is more likely to die of COVID when infected than a younger person. And then there are also issues related to social isolation, what we call reverse quarantine. All the measures of social distancing and isolation have a much bigger impact, negative impact on the elderly. Next one, please. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this is, I'm going back to that first one, the vulnerability issues. It has been proved, this again, that my previous speaker has shown slides on this. Age is the most important factor in diminishing one's chances of survive COVID-19, especially after 65. After 65, your age is the most important factor to decide whether you die of COVID or whether you survive COVID. And this is, again, for the elderly, this is not just for COVID. This is also the same for many other diseases, for example, pneumococcal pneumonia, heat stroke. Yeah, after the age of 65, your chance of dying with an infection, pneumonia is much more, your heat stroke is much more. But then the one major difference is that the mortality from COVID-19 is much higher than the mortality from pneumococcal pneumonia or heat stroke. So this is a major health challenge, a major cause of mortality among elderly. So this one, the old age homes, again, institutions, they are particularly vulnerable. They are particularly vulnerable for respiratory diseases. And also, like, so they, because older people staying together, you might have seen this already, even in countries like Sweden, they opened up. A major mortality was from old age homes. In our situation, even Kerala, we have seen a fairly large number of people getting infected in, because common facilities for eating together, and then carers coming from the community. So there are various loopholes there, various gaps in the system, which can make them more prone for infections. Yeah, next one, please. Yeah, this is an interesting study. There was an interesting study. This is a free paper available on PLOS One. People have studied the response of various age groups in 27 countries. Total of around 73,000 people were studied. And they found that the global study, India unfortunately was not part of the country studied, but there are a lot of Asian countries in that. And one of the findings was that the preventive measures, when you take all the preventive measures like wearing masks, social distancing, sanitization, etc., you can see that the elderly, like slightly better how much do you follow that? Because the graph towards the lower axis is age and the upper axis is the x-axis, y-axis is compliance with the preventive measures, and you will see that slightly better goes slightly up, but not specifically. When you look at the risk, this should be much better. This should be actually all these campaigns to protect the elderly, all these campaigns which insist that the data which comes out saying that the elderly are more prone for infection, more prone for death when you're infected, so the best way is to prevent and all. But the compliance is not that good, slightly better. And then the next slide is much more important. Can I have the next slide? Yeah. When you look at specifically this wearing mask is considered as the single most important preventive measure. When you look at this incidence of the compliance with wearing masks, the global study again shows that you can see this. Yeah, actually, as they are much worse, the practice of wearing masks goes steeply down as the aging. So which means that adequate precautions are not being taken. Either the message is not getting across well, or there are not conditions favorable to this, or when then this is being neglected, or whatever happened. The current data, whatever available data from existing studies, show that the compliance to these preventive measures are much worse among the elderly. Next one, please. Next. And then this is one of the measures that has been advocated all over the world, and particularly in India and particularly in Kerala. It's a social isolation, what we call reverse quarantine. Because you try to isolate the people at risk, especially the elderly, so that they don't get infected. But it has a lot of other implications, both health-wise and well-being-wise, psychologically, emotionally. One, these are people who need regular services because they have multiple problems already, cardiovascular, autoimmune, neurocognitive, mental health problems. So they have been dependent on the healthcare system or the social service system, social support system, much more than the other population. Now you are isolating them, and that will mean a disruption of many services. And then also the social disconnection put the elderly at greater risk of depression and anxiety. We have had a lot of instances where people feel neglected, they feel isolated, feel depressed. And this the major, this is also known, self-isolation will disproportionately affect the elderly. And then for many of these older people, the only social contact is outside the home. And they either when they go to the church or temple, or when they go to the local tea shops or reading room, when they go in the evening and sit together with the other PA group measures. So the last 6 months, this has been totally cut off, which has a lot of implications on the emotional well-being of the elderly population. Next one, please. Next one. Yeah. Financial issues. 40% of, this I already mentioned, 40% of the elderly in India are below poverty line. How do they survive? Because in the past, they were surviving on income from odd jobs. The major, like when you look at the data on Mahatma Gandhi regional, rural employment scheme, guarantee scheme, a large number of people were elderly women, people more than aged above 60 and women. And they are also totally cut off from the source of income. So this is lack of job opportunities. So generally, there is an economic crunch. Generally, there is loss of income for many sections of the people, but the elderly is the most vulnerable among them. Next one, please. Yeah. So this is the summary. This is a very vulnerable group of section of the society. with multiple complex so then they were already really vulnerable, but the COVID has put an additional burden on them. And then with the again the focus on general population, focus on prevention of COVID, focus on treatment of COVID, also they get tend to get less attention, which complicates the matters for that. So yeah, any questions on this, I'll be happy to answer.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us. The session is now open for discussion. I request the participants to post their queries and comments in the chat box. Participants, you may please post your queries in the chat box. Yes, here we have the first question by Binu. Is single layered common mask useful for preventing microorganisms like COVID-19?
Yeah, this has been widely explored, and now people like various experts have come out with possible, but the studies have been done with aerosols and droplets. And they found that for the general population, the best option is a double layered mask. A single layer mask may be useful, but the general advice is to avoid single layer mask and go for double layer mask. And also what we call N95 masks only for the high risk population, that is healthcare workers and other people who. So general advisability is for two layer, not single layer. Single layer can also prevent to some extent, but it all depends on the size of the droplet. When you cough or sneeze, the person coughs or sneezes, the droplets coming out through the salivary droplets and mucosal droplets coming out. The size of it depends upon the force and then also the distance with which you stay. So two-layer mask can actually filter a larger number of droplets than the single layer mask. So general advisability is for single two layer mask.
Thank you, sir. Now, next question by Rajisha CR. How much is the risk for people with diabetes during COVID?
Could you please repeat that question? Yes, again? Sir.
How much is the risk for people with diabetes during COVID?
Yeah, diabetes, like they say that people who die of COVID, most people who die of COVID are people with comorbidities, other morbidities. And the two major comorbidities that has been associated with higher mortality is one is diabetes and the second one is chronic respiratory disease. Diabetes particularly shows a very high risk. Like when you look at the comorbidities, hypertension, cardiovascular diseases, renal diseases, respiratory disease, diabetes, and or cancer. Diabetes is high, particularly uncontrolled diabetes. The controlled diabetes is slightly better, but diabetes has a much higher. Somebody with diabetes and another person without diabetes, if both get COVID, the person with diabetes is more prone for complication, and more prone for longer hospitalization, and more prone for death.
So another question again on the use of mask by Simla Thomas. Sir, please let us know how we can reuse N95 mask.
Yeah, there have been suggestion that okay, because this infected particle or the if you leave the mask in sun. Sunlight or untouched for 3 days, it become disinfected. So what I've been suggested is that you keep a set of four masks and number them. Use number one on day one. Keep it aside on day two. Day two, take the number two, and so that you will be reusing the number one only on the fourth day. fifth day, actually, if you have 4 sets of masks. So like when you use it for 1 day, like keep it aside for 3 days minimum, and then you can reuse it. You can reuse it. There are some confusion as to how many times you can reuse it, but generally they say that you can reuse it 6 to 7 times. So this is the usual pattern that is suggested. 3 days, minimum 3 days for sterilization. You can keep it aside for 3 days and then reuse it.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Tejaswi Uma Bharati. Most of the elderly people are feeling uncomfortable by wearing a mask. Is there any alternative, sir, for elders?
Yeah, this is most of, like, generally the wearing mask is quite new to most of us. For the Southeast Asian population, after this SARS virus infection a few years ago, they started wearing mask and they are more comfortable with it. But this is a question of getting habituated, because for most people, even the, it's not just for the elderly, like generally people see it as a barrier, like there's a discomfort, and also when you talk or when you smile, expression wise, identifying, there's a lot of issues. But I think we have to live with it, because COVID is here to stay. Because they are talking about a vaccine, but generally it's likely that the pandemic may subside, but this will still be around as endemic. So I think the practice of wearing masks, there is no other way other than our learning it and accepting it, because it is not comfortable. Yeah, but then we have no other way.
Okay, thank you, sir. So I find a lot of queries in the chat box. I'll be reading one by one. By Remya Rajan, her question is, can we propose radiation therapy to the cancer patient who is suffering from COVID-19? Is there any side effects?
Yeah, this is like the most of the patients with cancer and most of the patients with other non-communicable diseases are now started, like after the initial lockdown period and lack of availability of the treatment, now it's getting available. Like this is possible. Other than, like, it all depends on, like, there is not specific, okay, again we don't have exact data, but anecdotal evidence shows that there is no specific risk due to radiotherapy alone. Even somebody, like, people have been undergoing chemotherapy that causes immunodepression, but so when you compare between results of, like, what will happen if you give up chemotherapy or if you give up radiotherapy as against what will happen if you continue with it, generally the advice is to continue.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Shruti. Sir, you have a famous institute in palliative care, so your patients will be bedridden. So what facilities will be offered for COVID patients in your institution?
This is again, this is something that we have been finding really difficult to address, because the most of our other palliative patients, like, this is again, this is a time when people need a lot of contact with each other, a lot of emotional support, people sitting with them, talking to them, and also good symptom relief. So a lot of physical contact and interaction. But when somebody is COVID positive and dying, one major issue is that, okay, the staff will be in personal protection gear, PPE kit. Family is not allowed to visit, and if one or two people are allowed to visit, they will be also be in PPE, which actually is a major barrier to communication. And also there are issues, like very delicate issues, like say giving up a treatment, withdrawal of a treatment, and all. So this is something that we have been finding it difficult. But the physical symptoms, the major physical symptoms that we come across in the advanced COVID. One, respiratory breathlessness, and also some patient delirium and some of the neurological problem, which can be controlled fairly well with the available medication. But we are finding that covering the emotional aspects of the disease and social aspects of the disease difficult. But we are trying to do that again when the carer is in the personal protection gear with the face covered and in the gown and the gloves and all, the patient in mask, it's very difficult to communicate, but we are trying to. This is a complicated situation. Yeah.
And a question by Sana, how much is the risk for people with heart disease?
Yeah, the, when you look at the pathology, the pathophysiology of the of COVID infection, it basically affects what we call the AC2 AC2 receptors, which is present in red blood cells, heart, respiratory system, and also neurologic system. And then again, the long term impact is yet to be known. But we now realize that it can cause embolism, clotting in various parts. It can also cause demyelination of some of the neurons. So what being said is that it can cause myocarditis. This has been proved that it can cause myocarditis, which is infection of the heart. Now, again, something, there was a question earlier with the previous speaker about the immunity. The problem with COVID, the actually you die not, most people do not die with the, due to the virus. Not most people who die of COVID, or almost all who die of COVID, die of immunological system going haywire. The response, body's response to the virus, the antibodies generated, it attacks, in addition to the virus, it attacks the body organs also. It attacks the microvasculature, it attacks the heart. It is our own body attacking ourselves. This is more like so. There is a risk. There is a risk, like particularly at the, during the infection, there is a risk of mild myocarditis, which actually is inflammation of the cardiac tissue. And there is a risk of embolism, that is means clots being formed in vascular blood vessels and getting released to the circulation. And this is the problem again is something that we have started realizing now is that it does not end when you are tested negative. Like you initially you'll find the virus in your body. That's when the RT-PCR test give a positive result or the antigen test give a positive result. Later on, the virus disappears from the body. You are no longer infective. But the impact of the system, impact of the virus on the body continues. And with a lot of people are now coming out back with post-COVID symptoms, breathlessness, heart attacks, also the neurological symptoms, fatigue. So this is the definitely there is a risk to the heart.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, if a cancer patient is COVID positive, we will take a break from his treatment. Is there any problem when stopping the treatment?
What was it? Could you please repeat again?
If a cancer patient is COVID positive, he will take a break from his treatment. Is there any problem in breaking this treatment?
It depends. Some of the chemotherapeutic agents or radiotherapeutic regimens, like actually, it attacks the cancer system at frequent intervals so that regular intervention need to be maintained. But delaying it can definitely like impair the results of the chemotherapy or radiotherapy. But having said this, I fully understand that in certain situations, because of some of the facilities are not available sometimes and some of the time that patient is not in a position to get shifted and all. So this is inevitable, but if at all possible, it's better to follow the original regimen.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Deepa L. Use of mixed spices on daily basis, will it be helpful to improve the immune system?
Yeah, this issue of boosting of the immune system, improving the immune system is a little bit controversial because there is no evidence so far to show that any of these agents can boost the immune system. Like there are two situations. One is a normal immune system, and second is a immunodeficiency, which it can happen with some of the disease condition, some of these congenital abnormalities, some other. If you have an immune deficiency, you have to bring it back to the normal level with various specific immune therapy aimed at immune boosting that particular deficiency. But general immune boosters, there is no proof to show that there is these can actually boost your immunity. And as I mentioned earlier, the issue is not a issue with COVID disease. It's not a unboosted immune system. Issue with COVID disease is the immune system going haywire, immune system reacting in an abnormal way to the virus. So that's the issue. So that can happen even with a so-called boosted immune system or with a like unboosted immune system. So these agents which claim to boost the immune system, the modern medical system and also the available evidence, there is nothing to support that. But having said that, these are all fairly harmless entities. And if you boost your feeling of well-being, well and good. But don't if you do that, stick to the other measures like wearing masks, social distancing, sanitization, etc. Because don't trust the so-called booster and give up the other measures.
So, a question by Shashi Sharma: how much we can rely on COVID test results? It is said available tests are not so accurate.
That's true. But this is only what's like they say that the RT-PCR, which tests the presence of genetic viral material in the body and the swab, this is considered to be around 80% reliable. One problem with RT-PCR is that even if there are some remnants, like the virus enters the body, does its damage, then the virus get destroyed, die out, and there will be some stray harmless genetic material in the body. That will also be picked up by the RT-PCR, which we call as the result will be positive, but the person may not have that viral presence. And that is, but again, 78% to 80% is okay. Antigen test, which are now used in a large scale, it's only 70% as effective as the RT-PCR, which means 70-80% that the other one is 80%, and this is only 70% of that 80%. So around less than 60% positive reliable. So this is, there are issues actually. You can get, even if you are tested positive, a small percentage of them may not be positive. And if you are tested negative, that does not mean that always mean that you are negative. So this is the antigen, average antigen test is around less than 60% reliable. Average RT-PCR, the genetic test, is around 80% reliable. Then there are also issues about it's all tested in a swab. If the swab is nasal swab is not taken properly, you miss the virus. So this is also but the test as such is so much reliable. But then actual practical issues like taking the swab is also there.
Thank you, sir. Here's a question by Shalini Gupta. And this most of us want to know also. It's a very interesting question by Shalini, and it is in Hindi. I'll read it out, sir. Sir, kisi ko symptoms nahi dikhta, fir bhi COVID hota hai, to kaise bache use?
What was it?
Sir, kisi ko symptoms nahi dikhte, fir bhi COVID hota hai, to kaise bache use?
How do you escape? Yes. That is the question, no?
Yes, a person may show no symptoms, but still be COVID positive.
Actually, around 60% do not show any symptoms. 60% do not show any symptoms, but then there is also evidence that the level of infectivity among the symptomatic is quite low. Like a person showing symptoms is more likely to transmit the virus than a person not showing symptoms. But there is no, it's very difficult to, it's not possible. It's not possible to test everybody in the country and identify people with, and also you have to test more frequently to identify. That's not possible. So the practically what we can do is, we can protect ourselves. Assume that every other person is a potential infectious person. So that's why people insist on this wearing mask and then social distancing, and so avoid a social gathering, wash the hands with soap and water. So the only way we can do this is protecting ourselves. Because you cannot identify all the infectious people around us and isolate them. That is not possible. because fairly large percentage of them are 60% are asymptomatic, and another 15% are with mild symptoms. They may have a mild fever for a day or a irritating cough for a couple of days and it disappears. So we have to assume that the environment, people around you are likely to be infected, and you have to take the precaution. That's the only way out.
So here's another interesting question by Rajisha CR. Is there any chance for long-term side effects due to use of hand sanitizers?
Very unlikely. They say that if you use sanitizer, no? What is sanitizer?
Yes, sir. Hand sanitizers.
Okay. Yeah, the dermatologists have pointed out that it can dry up the skin a little bit, and continuous regular use can sometimes lead to some amount of dermatitis. But if the sanitizer is of good quality, that is, around 70% alcohol and then 10% glycerol and some hydrogen peroxide in it, then it's okay. This okay. But the problem with this is that there are also a lot of spurious products in the market, which may cause further dermatitis, skin allergy and inflammation. But if you use the proper sanitizer and if you use it properly, and again, having said that, the main advice is actually to go for soap and water, not for sanitizer, not for the alcohol-based one. So you use sanitizer only if there's no facility for hand washing available. Soap and water is not available, because that has been proved to be the best one. Like soap and water for 30 seconds, thorough hand washing is proved to be much superior than using an alcohol-based sanitizer. But long-term use, again, yeah, but not much damage. There are some people with sensitive skin who may want to avoid it. But otherwise, in the healthy population, risk is not that much, except for a little bit of dehydration and occasional inflammation to the skin.
Thank you, sir. Another question by Neetu Vanwani. Hello, sir. This is Neetu. I'm suffering from corona and isolated in home. Sir, how can I make my immunity power strong, and what should I do for that?
I covered this earlier, but then something that you can do is one, plenty of water, hydration, good hydration, and good sleep, sleep in time, and also no exercise during the period of COVID, because your heart muscles are more prone for complications at that time, and a fairly balanced diet. And this is all that we can do near normal. But there are no, you can use any of these so-called boosters, but that will not have any impact on you. Basically, follow this. Follow well hydration, that is a lot of water, nutritious diet, and also good sleep, and no exercises during the period.
A question by Jyoti G. Is it compulsory to get CT scan and blood test in post-COVID?
No. But if you have post-COVID symptoms, that a lot of patients after discharge now come back with symptoms. Main symptom is fatigue, tiredness, and then also breathlessness. And also some of these, what I call this, coagulation, clot related issues, and some amount of confusion, or what we call post-stress disorders, post-traumatic stress disorder. The a CT scan is advised only CT chest, not brain. A CT scan is advised only if you present with breathlessness, and to look at the damage that the lung has got. Breathlessness is also advised only if you present with any of these post-COVID symptoms, but not otherwise.
Thank you, sir. Another question is there any impact of COVID on patients with liver dysfunctions?
Yes, definitely. People with liver dysfunctions, again, have a much higher chance of complications and death when compared to people with normal liver. Liver dysfunction is actually one of the high risk category. Hello.
Sir, thank you, sir. I think we had a very active discussion, and thank you, participants, and thank you, Dr. Suresh, for the informative lecture and sharing your views. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. It has been really interesting. Like good participation, good discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Now the next speaker is in line, Dr. Dharani Krishnan, a well-known nutritionist and former president of Indian Dietetic Association, is now working as a consultant dietitian and the director, DV Living Sciences Enterprises Private Limited. She is the brain behind Digest, a personalized diet software, and has developed a health website, the first of its kind in India. She has also developed an application for Android mobile phones on diet and exercise, known as NutriTrax. I think she is the most apt person for delivering the talk on how to make geriatric people eat right. I invite you, ma'am, to deliver the lecture.
Thank you so much, and thank the organizers for inviting me. And just give me a second while I display my slides.
Sure, ma'am.
Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thanks again for the opportunity, and it is indeed a great pleasure to be here. And I am going to talk on the topic, how to make the geriatric people eat right. I have had personal experiences with geriatric people at the home front, with friends. We have handled people 95 plus and even almost 100. And now we are handling somebody who is 101. So if I said that somebody was 100 plus, say, 10 years ago, people really wouldn't be so, they would run to see, oh, somebody did turn 100. But today it's quite the norm, because in every street or every neighbor or every family, there is somebody who is almost reaching 100. And if they reach 100, everybody is celebrating. But this one lady I remember said, it's 2 months for me to reach 100. Everybody is excited, but I am not. So this is how they feel, because they do have a lot of problems in their body. Now, as we move on, I want to define old age itself. Old age is best defined as an age of retirement. But I think in our country, we are looking at retirement at 60. But people living above 90 is quite common today. So I think we need to change that definition a little, because we really are looking at a geriatric population 60 and above. But those who are 80 and above need very good care. And once they come to the ninth decade of their life, every year or every 6 months, the way their life changes is quite a challenge to them. So nutrition for old age is known as geriatric nutrition. And I remember way back in 1984 or something, the first geriatric ward was opened in the General Hospital in Chennai, here where I am from. So geriatric nutrition became more common, and more interest was generated into it, I think, in the 80s plus. Now, aging brings physiological, psychological, and immunological changes. Now, what is geriatrics? Geriatrics is the branch of medicine dealing with health problems of the elderly, delaying degeneration and threatening disease of the aged. Gerontology deals with the psychological, social, economic, physiological problems of the elder. I think when we had, the system of 30 people living under one roof, the joint family system, I think finance was not major issue, but today finance is a big issue for the 90 plus. So when somebody is not 90, not out, we are very, very happy. But today in our country, people feel they are old when they are 60 plus. I meet so many people who are retired, and they think, oh, we are done. Now, you know, we have to start thinking of the last few years of our life. But that's not true. Now, if we take people 90 plus in our country, they become very frail. They have less muscle in their body and they're not able to walk. But on the same note, if we take the Western countries, 90 plus people are able to shovel the snow, which is a very, very difficult thing. Now, why? What is the major difference? And that is one nutrient called protein, which even our younger adults are deficient in, and our 90 plus are very deficient in. So we really need to take a look at that. So 90 plus in different countries is different. One in India, they are frail. But there is an example of the South where I have seen in the villages of Kerala, there are people living independently, almost reaching 100 or above 100. So that is the quality of life we want our elders to have. And in that, we dietitians and doctors have a very major role to play. So what is aging itself? It is loss of teeth. It is decreased neuromuscular coordination, impaired hearing and vision, diminished sense of taste and smell, anorexia, and physical discomfort. But in loss of teeth, I have something to say. Where even people at 45, 50 have dentures, but actually people above 80 in this country have fairly a good quantity of teeth and they are able to chew their food. So there's something in that generation, the way they eat, what they ate, and the kind of lifestyle they did lead, did bring a lot of resistance exercise, and the bones is actually healthier. So there are some tips we need to take from that generation to the younger generations to live more healthy. Coming to socio-psychological problems, food habits, economic aspects, loneliness, depression, anxiety, everything is a problem. Today, if you find for food habits, they really feel that they need food like almost a toddler. If you take the previous time when I spoke about people living under the same roof, 30 plus people, there were people of every generation. There would always be a toddler at home. So it was not difficult to make food for them separately. But today it's a big challenge because getting, like when you even get food into the house, because they may not be able to make it themselves. What happens is the texture needs to be soft, solid. It needs to have the taste they are used to. And these are big, big problems. So food habits, we need to actually in detail as dietitians, check what is it that they were eating. And if it is a rasam that they like, we could add the rasam to whatever you are adding. Like some of them even move to very liquid diets. For example, they may have only 300 ml of something. In that 300 ml, you have to make it nutrient dense. But if you are adding protein supplements, that's not the taste they would like. So maybe you could mix the protein supplements in buttermilk or curd and add the masalas that they like, or even add one little, 2 to 3 tablespoons of rasam or sambar or whatever they like, the North Indian sabji, which will add the taste that they're used to and they may take it better. So the socio-psychological thing is a big problem, and anxiety is something they are having, because I remember the family member who used to say, is there a ladder for me to go up? I'm already 96. You know, how long am I going to live like this? And things like that. But we need to encourage them that it's so wonderful. You know, read the newspaper, interact with them. Then anxiety can be reduced. The loss of independence is a big problem. We need to encourage them to do simple things. Even to cut a tomato. Then they feel part of the family. then you know it helps a lot. You can make a dish and go and show to them and say, is this the right texture? Do you want to help us to make it better? You know, things like that, very simple things. But it gives them a big confidence that they are part of the family. They're not alone. Loneliness will be less. And economic aspects, I think, if there is a family around them, they don't really have to worry about that. Now, what really happens in the aged people, and why is the diet that we give them changing? If you take the BMR, the basic metabolic rate, it comes down. They have reduced muscle mass. Physical activity is reduced. In fact, if they are able to walk till the last day of their life, that's fantastic, because bed sores can be reduced. They feel that they're doing something. And that thing of when they walk to the entrance of the apartment or the house and they see the road, they feel very happy because they feel they are interacting with the world. They do have increased fat tissue. So we have to change the way the diet is given to them and planned to them a little different from normal adults. So how we are looking now at the ICOPE, which is a program given by the WHO, where they see that services needed to the older people has to be different. If you take Germany, they take care of all the elders by providing the food they need at their doorstep. I know in villages in India where there are people who adopt this, and when people are living alone, they are NGOs which take care of the food which they deliver to their homes. So this is something very nice, and a comprehensive assessment of the care plan should be provided. A common care and treatment goals across different providers is important. Community outreach and home-based interventions. This is fantastic today, because when I was taking care of my family member, today we do have ECG at home, we have at the bedside X-rays, we have so many facilities which can, even ultrasound, which can be done at the bedside at home. So I thank the medical fraternity for providing this to us, because if they even fall, we need to know, is it a fracture or is it something else? If they do have a cyst in their GI tract, we need to know where it is and how it is worrying them. Do we really need to intervene? Do they need help? Because taking them to a hospital setup is a big challenge as they age. We may have the wheelchairs around, but especially in the pandemic situation, we do not want to expose them to so many things. So we need to support self-management, but for those who are not able to do it, we need to give them home-based help. Comprehensive referral and monitoring processes. Today, India has this. Community engagement and caregiver support. Again, India has this. So I'm very proud to say that we do have this already, and we just need to make it better and better so that the aged, wherever they are, they can be taken care of. You have to give them improved musculoskeletal function, mobility and vitality. I remember the family member, the moment she would see the physiotherapist as well, the doctor visiting, the smile would go there and she would say, good morning, what can we do today? So they are waiting for somebody to help them walk around. They're waiting to for somebody to help them and tell them that everything is fine for them, to take their basic vitals and say, wow, you're doing very well. So this gives a big smile to them and a big day to look forward to. So even if different people can come on different days, it brings that spark into their life. So oral supplementation, nutritional, dietary advice has to be recommended, because they should not go into undernutrition, which can affect their musculoskeletal function. Yeah, we know we will be discussing further on protein and how we are going to handle that. So nutritional status has to be assessed And according to that, we have to give integrated care plans and deliver together as a team, a dietitian, doctor, physiotherapist, and a nurse if need be, and how many ever things needed to be added on for that specific individual. Prevent severe cognitive impairment and promote psychological well-being. Today, lot of them even can handle computers or on the phone. In fact, I gave a talk to a senior citizen welfare association. You will be so surprised that they all know how to use the common platforms to receive a talk. There were about 30 of them who were there at the talk that day and are asking so many questions related to the pandemic and diet and how they should be changing their diet. So this is something fantastic that our senior population are able to reach out, and this way they can reach out to the family wherever they are, their grandchildren, their well-wishers and friends, even during the pandemic. So to prevent cognitive decline, they need interaction with live people, with their grandchildren, great-grandchildren, with their own children, with their friends. This brings a lot of positivity into them and can reduce cognitive issues. Now, preventing falls, this is very, very difficult. In fact, yesterday I had a geriatric mother. I was standing right next to her and she had a fall. So you have to be very, very careful with them when they are very, very weak. Not on a daily basis, when they're very weak, we have to encourage them to use walkers. They need to do exercise. In fact, she does exercise regularly, but there are some problems here and there. They do miss the directions sometimes. So we need to be there to help them. Even if personally we are not able to be there, on days that they are very, very weak, we have to help them. What we keep around them is very important. No loose rugs, no clutter in the room, no poor lighting, no, you know, different problems. Like, you know, if we don't give them enough exercise in a day, they are going to lose the muscle capacity for their body to able to hold them. So we need to really take many, many actions and steps and keep encouraging them, because they fall, then it's very difficult to encourage them to walk when they may not have any fracture, but they are scared of the experience that they had. So we have to treat them like kids at that time and make them get up and move around, and that would be wonderful. Maintain their sensory capacity, because routine screen of their visual impairment could be there. Today, this is also available at home, which is wonderful. You know, provision of hearing aids if they need it, because only then they can hear their family, they can hear people around, and the very sound of a friend will make them so happy. So we need to look into these issues. Manage age-associated conditions such as urinary incontinence. This is very, very common. One, because they do not know that they are not drinking water. Specifically in summer, I urge the dietitians to watch into this, because I have handled so many geriatric people. They do not have the sense of thirst. So they forget to drink water when they're actually losing water through sweating extra through, you know, in the summer months. So you need to take care, give them a flask or give them a way in which they can measure the water, or the caregivers can measure the water. I can give you an example of a geriatric person who went into cardiac issues. Now, because of the cardiac issues, they put them on 800 ml of water. Now, the person initially was having a liter and a half or 2 liters. So this itself was psychologically affecting the person. Now, measuring and having this 800 ml, after a while, that person slipped into urinary, tract infection. So urinary incontinence is one problem, but those issues related to the urinary things are many more. So for incontinence, you can give them pelvic floor exercises. But if further they have a problem, use of diapers have to be there, and that has to be maintained and clean. Otherwise, sores and other problems can come. Now, support caregivers, they also need psychological help, because they are with the elderly always, and we need to help them. So we need to give them also training to make it okay. So now we'll go on to the nutritive value. Calorie wise, we need 15 to 30 calories. Even if they are 60 kilos or 58 kilos, we need to give them 1800 calories, and it's a huge challenge, believe me, to make them eat so much. Carbohydrates, yes, today everybody for diabetes is talking about low carbs, but for the elders, we have to look at higher carbs, and if they are able to digest the complex carbohydrate, which will provide the vitamins and minerals, that's fine. But if they're taking very little, we may need to dip into the refined carbs, because it will give them the extra calories, which they may not be getting. Now, 0.8 to 1 gram of protein is the biggest challenge. 50 gram of protein, and if they are vegetarian or non-vegetarian, the quantities they take are so less, and we need to work on this. So they may need supplements. We may need to cheat the supplement into their buttermilk, or into the soup, or even into the sambar, because the quantities they are having are so less, so we need to make it nutrient dense. Avoid trans fats, and 25 to 30% of fat, that shouldn't be difficult. We can add the extra oil into something, like suppose they're taking idli or dosa, we can add it to that. Or if they're taking even dal rice, we can add it to that. Or if they're taking paratha, we can add it to that. But saying that saturated fat should be less than 10%, very important, because most of them may have cardiac issues. MUFA we need to increase, and PUFA we have to keep it within 10% and reduce the cholesterol intake. Now this is the pyramid for the old age or the geriatric population, which has been suggested from the USDA. Now, believe me, the geriatric population love their sweets. If they are not diabetic, please give it to them. Again, the example where they love their chocolates. They have not seen or eaten the variety of chocolates that has come into our country now. If they can digest it, if they do not have diabetes, please give it to them at least twice a week. I would increase it from once to twice, because they would meet their calories, and it will keep them, give them the satiety also. Now, if they are taking poultry, free-range poultry, if it's available twice a week, and oil, we can give any traditional oil in India. In the north, you can give mustard oil. In the south, we can give coconut oil, which is very good for them, even for cognitive health. We can give them sesame oil. We can give them groundnut oil. And daily, we can give them the low glycemic, but in their case, if they're not able to take the whole, like for rice, they can't take the red rice, you can give them semi-polished. If they're not able to digest that also, you can give them the white rice, but we can avoid the maida and the corn flour. We can, because the white rice, we can mix dal, we can mix vegetables, we can mix many more things and give it to them. And if you are looking at, millets, again, we have processed millets which they can digest. You can make the tiffin items like upma with the millets and add a little extra dal and little extra vegetable, which can go into that. So now, how do we make them eat is a big change. So there are some people who are used to a 10:30 meal. Please do not change their meal timings, because they need to maintain their meal timings. Otherwise, that can lead to a problem. You can start designing a meal in a cup so that it has the protein. It has carbs are always there. It is the protein and the fiber which will go missing. We need to design that in a cup so that we can give it to them in smaller quantities. They are able to meet their protein needs, fiber needs, vitamin meals, and so on. Milkshake is a good option because the fruit can be put into it and it is thick. And if you want, you can add the protein supplement to it. Smoothies are excellent. You can add the vegetables to it and you can add little buttermilk or curd and again the protein supplement or a little dry fruits to make it more better. Now, idli with oil or sugar, because we normally say don't give sugar, you can give jaggery, but if they are not meeting their regular needs and if they are not diabetic and if this would make them eat better, why not? You can give it to them. Pongal and sambar, add extra ghee. Now, coming to ghee, I have a big story there. Now, I would like the organizers to tell me how many more minutes I have, because I forgot to see when I started the thing. If they can just appraise me on how many more minutes I have.
Ma'am, you can continue.
For another 5 minutes?
Yes, ma'am, sure.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so this story about the ghee is, butter in the, you know, cooperatives is actually skimmed fat from the milk. So skimmed fat is not the butter that we have been using in this country. So how is butter made? Just to reiterate, all of us know it. You need to ferment the milk to curd. You skim off the cream. And the cream, you make butter. And then from that butter, you make ghee. So recent studies have shown that the ghee made this way from cow's milk, and if it is an A2 cow's milk, the ghee contains good fats which are heart friendly. So if you have excess, because today I know a lot of my patients are buying organic cow's milk. So in which case they can make this ghee. And if a family member can provide it to them, or the commercial organizations which are supplying food to the geriatric population, can make the right ghee, it can definitely be given, because it is not high in saturated fat. It does have the heart healthy fat. So ghee should be made the right way. It has to be made from the A2 milk, or at least a cow which is thinner, not the Jersey cow. And then we are right there, because this can provide the right fats to the elders. And even if we give a little more of that, it will not increase the saturated fat percentage. Now, soft solid diet, very important. Soups. Yes, Western soups, we know how to make a creamy soup, but some people may not like that flavor. That's when you add the regular dishes which they are used to, you can add. Suppose they are having a dal tadka, you can add the dal tadka to the soup. And that masala will make them eat better rather than the regular masalas which are added to the soups. Now, coming to seasonings, we can use multiple seasonings. Like, for example, banana stem is something all the elders of the south have grown up with. They may not be able to chew into it. You can grind it and add it to the soup. If they are able to take the fiber, fantastic. But if they're not able to, add just a tablespoon and then they'll be able to take it. Or else, at least you can take a fresh plantain stem, you can grind it, remove the juice and add it, which gives a lot of benefit to them. Steamed foods are very nice, but they may not like it. Instead of, you know, normally adding broccoli, which they've never eaten in their lives, because broccoli is something which has come recently. But cauliflower is something they've grown up with, you know, cabbage they've grown up with, all the traditional vegetables, whether it's broad beans, whether it's, you know, the brinjals. And today we know we have a huge biodiversity of brinjals. If they like the bhartha, make it like the bhartha. If they like it, you know, the simple, you know, dry vegetable we make, you can put all the masalas, but reduce the chili, reduce the oil, and make it to them, and add that to whatever you have, a steamed carrot or something, then they will eat it. But if you give a steam dish like served in the regular hotels, no geriatric person will take it because they're not used to it and they've never had it. So thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm very happy to take any questions. I will stop sharing my screen so that we can now take the questions.
Thank you, ma'am, for the informative lecture. The participants may interact with Dr. Dharani through the chat box. Here's the first question by Rajisha CR. Geriatric patients are commonly found to have gas trouble. What should be could be the reason, and what changes could be brought in dietary pattern to avoid this condition?
It's an excellent question. Thank you, Rajisha. See, the thing is, for them, the digestive power is going down. So instead of giving normal tea and coffee, if you can give them dry ginger tea. What is dry ginger tea? Just dry ginger powder. You just make it and you boil it for a while, just for 2 to 3 minutes, and you strain it and add a little bit of jaggery and give it. Or if they are diabetic, you can add the artificial sweetener and give it. This 3 to 4 times a week, if you give it to them, actually will give you a very good way of helping the gas problem. You can add fresh ginger to all the dishes that you're preparing, and that can prevent this problem. But if they have acidity, do not give the dry ginger tea too often. You can give it once or twice. The next herb, which is very useful for gas problem and digestion, basically their digestion is not happening, that is why they have this problem, is ajwain. All of us know omam water was given to young children when they had gas problems. So if they are able to bite into ajwain, give them a little roasted ajwain. It's a little spicy. You can give it with a little fig, or you can give it with 2 to 3 raisins, which will make the spicy part go down. But otherwise, you can boil it in water and give them the water. So these are all situations you can handle when an elderly has a gas problem.
Thank you, ma'am. There's another question by Maria Antony. Are diabetic patients more prone to gastrointestinal disorders?
Not necessary. It depends on the medicines they are taking and how many years the medicines and if it has any side effects. Right, we can't give a blanket statement like that, but it's not necessary. Okay, yeah.
Another diabetic related question by Shruti PM. Most of the geriatric patients are diabetic, so can we recommend sorbitol? Is there any side effects? What about stevia?
Yeah, stevia is better because it's a natural supplement and it can be given, and as of now the side effects are very minimal, and hence stevia. But don't overuse artificial sweeteners also, because overuse of artificial sweeteners changes the microbiome inside the person, and this actually leads to other problems and actually leads to digestive issues. So best would be to use stevia only when needed. Don't overdo anything. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question by Ramya Rajan. How can we improve age-related renal impairment through nutrition?
Yeah, renal impairment is a very big topic because it could be early creatinine or it could be many, many issues. So we need to know what really it is. If you're talking about early stages of chronic renal failure, then yes. But as I told you, our country is eating less protein. So you first check the amount of protein they are having, and we are saying 0.8 to 1, which is the ICMR recommendation for adults, right? So if they are early CRF, please don't pull out more protein, then it will be quite catastrophic for them. But if they are advanced stage of CRF, then we need to give the right type of protein, a mix of high biological value protein from dairy for vegetarians and a little bit of chicken and fish and eggs for non-vegetarians, because they should be able to digest it. The easiest way would be to make a soup where we don't have to add the extra oil or the extra spices. So this way we can make the protein better. 50% can be high biological value protein and 50% can be the regular dals and other protein.
Here's a question raised by Asiya Fahima. Is there any relation with low sodium in geriatric patient and also the protein intake?
See, low sodium is a big issue because they like hyponatremia can create a lot of problems. See, normally we say if they have BP, we have to reduce sodium. But in elders, the problem is that they are not eating enough. So they may not be getting enough sodium. If they are having that quarter teaspoon of pickle or something, they may be getting. So offhand, I can't tell you, but we need to assess their diet. If their sodium is less, then please add it to them in whatever way they like, even a lime juice with salt, because even if they're diabetic, they can take that. So things like that can be, or the buttermilk can have a little more salt. So it depends on how they're eating, what they're eating, because some elders don't touch pickle at all. So it all depends.
Kirtana Sethanath says, geriatric age group people are found to have thyroid dysfunction problems. What can be the diet recommendations for them?
Yeah, actually thyroid, they have increased the numbers. The normal numbers, which is for adults, they are saying for hypothyroid, because hypothyroid actually shows a higher number when we take the TSH. So they have come out with now numbers saying that even a higher number, you cannot, you know, say they are in hypothyroid, because aging is a process which creates that. Okay, but coming back to the diet, basically reduce their broccoli, cabbage and cauliflower. Don't say complete no to them, because somebody may love it. So give it to them in smaller quantities in a big mixed vegetable. Add a few pieces of cauliflower so they feel happy that, you know, they are having cauliflower, rather than saying a big no to them. So geriatric people have to be handled like children who are 3 to 5 years old, and that's very important. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Shashi Sharma is asking, is taking antacids regularly okay? Does it hinder digestion and absorption of nutrients?
Definitely a long-term intake of antacids will affect nutrient absorption. But what is the choice, right? Once they become old, because to prevent acidity, it's given to them. So maybe you give extra, like anyway, all of them are on supplements for vitamins and minerals. They all will be taking a multivitamin tablet, which also has the minerals. So nothing much to worry about, because the doctors will take care of that. We don't really have to enter that area and worry too much about it.
Ma'am, Archana P. Unnikrishnan wants to know, what are the reasons for the loss of appetite that commonly seen in geriatric groups, and how can we overcome that?
See, loss of appetite, maybe they are bounded to the bed itself. Okay, second, very little activity or no activity. Third, see, unless you move around, you'll feel that you are feeling hungry. So psychologically it affects them. I'm lying down, why should I eat? You know, I haven't walked at all, why should I eat? So this is playing behind their mind. And then it is also the gastrointestinal system which is getting affected. So that is why we should use a lot of ginger, as I told you, then jeera or cumin, which is very good for digestion. We should use, you know, powders that we know how to make at home. A little bit chili, a little more pepper, a little bit of coriander seeds, and then a little bit of dals, whether it's urad or whether it's Bengal gram dal. You roast them in very little oil, and then you dry pudina leaves or coriander leaves, and then you know you make powders out of this, right? So this will, even one teaspoon will give a full digestive capacity to them, which is fantastic, you know. Like if you see the older times, people used to have long pepper, which is called arsi tikli in the south, but I wouldn't know the name in the north. But you can use that for once in a way, even when they're going to get a cold, we can make a small powder of this and add it to something. You know, even quarter teaspoon is enough. It will help create the digestion better. You can give, suppose the digestion is so bad, they're not eating, you can give sour buttermilk because it has the good probiotics. But again, I would like to mention here that curd made at home has 30,000 different good bacteria, but curd bought out has only 5 to 6 different types of bacteria, because they have to set the same texture when they sell the curd, right? So we need to use home curd. We need to allow it to sour and give a little bit of that. You know, just take 1 tablespoon, add 1 tablespoon of water, add a bit of either whatever spice you want, either ginger or jeera or little salt, and give it to them. And that will help them a lot, because this helps in digestion itself.
Another question.
Yeah.
What are the dietary changes that old people have to follow during COVID period? Question raised by Amrita UA.
Everybody, it's not just old people. We have to have all the immune boosters. As the previous speaker said, the immune booster cannot prevent COVID. It can only help you maintain your immunity better. Okay. So don't think that by eating all this, you can prevent COVID. That's not what we are doing. We are just trying to make the immune system better. Add a little iron, definitely regularly, vitamin C, zinc, selenium. All this may come from the tablets for them. But naturally, you can give amla, because lime some people cannot take. If they are wheezing, just amla can be given. Raw amla, they may not be able to take. Just boil the amla in a little bit of salt and a turmeric, and you can give it to them. Immediately, all the dietitians will pounce at me and say, if you boil amla, won't the vitamin C go? See, amla has 600 odd milligrams of vitamin C. If a little bit goes, still a lot is there. But vitamin C in lime juice is so less. If I reduce it, if I heat it, or if I leave it out for a long time, the whole amount of vitamin C is lost. So like this, there are many changes. And just eat normal traditional food. Automatically, you'll have all the spices and all the nutrients which are healthy for producing a better protein, of course. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Here's a query by Dr. Anju M. Neelyara. Atrophy of taste buds is happening in old age. We always suggest a bland diet. Is it okay if the individual prefers spicy foods to add spices?
Yeah, see, the problem is if they're able to tolerate the spices with whatever physiological issues they are facing, please give it to them. But it has to be a little less. Even a family which does spicy food, for a 3-year-old or 5-year-old, they will give less spice. So follow that. For example, I always say, if you want to give a less spicy rasam to them, make a dal rice, add the rasam and give it to them. So automatically the spice will go down. Similar for a sambar. So like that, if you have dal makhani, which is very spicy, keep a little plain dal for them, mix it and give it to them. That's all. So the oil also will be less, the spice also will be less, and they will enjoy it. Don't totally remove the spice and give them bland food. They will feel like they're sick. That is the problem. Okay? So let's encourage them to eat whatever spices they are used to in the level that they can take. Yeah.
A question by Anusri Sahu. Most of the geriatric person have diabetics and health problems. In this situation, can this person intake one egg every day?
Absolutely no problem. They can have three whole eggs a week, even if they have high cholesterol. They can take two egg whites on the other days. So if we have Monday to Sunday, we have 3 days, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, give them three whole eggs. The other 4 days, give them two egg whites. Nothing will happen. It's the most easily digestible food, easy to make. They can make it themselves, and it's good protein. So definitely they can, no problem.
Another question by Surya Suresh. Ma'am, please suggest some home nutrition remedies to prevent COVID virus in geriatric people.
Let me just read this. There was some noise in between. Please suggest some home nutritional remedies to prevent COVID. See, prevent COVID virus, keep them away from people. Don't have people go into their room. Only the caretaker should go into their room, because they are not comfortable wearing masks. If you have to take them out, please take them out with a mask. When they come back, completely sanitize them. Remove everything. Suppose they need to go to the hospital, remove everything when they come back, because they may not be ready for a second bath, but sanitize them completely. This is very, very important. And make them wash their hands whenever possible. Even take a bowl of warm water, they can wash it at the bed also. And if you do all this, and people who come, if you, you know, even their own sibling is coming to meet them, or their own child, ask them to wear masks and come and maintain the distance of 5 feet instead of 3 feet to be more careful. Nutrient wise, give them normal food. Make sure there's protein in two meals. Make sure the dairy 400 ml is there. This will take care of their protein. Make sure small quantities of fruit is given. Make sure vegetables are given at least half cup twice a day, either as soup or as cooked vegetable, and add the green, orange, and yellow wherever possible. These are the simple nutrition tips.
A question by Tejaswi Uma Bharati. What kind of food can be given for obese elders?
Obese elders simply follow the MyPlate system, where the quarter of the plate will be the carbs, quarter will be the protein, and double will be the vegetable. If they are not able to take, you know, dry sabji or gravies, make soups and give it to them. Once the pandemic moves off, you can give them a little bit of salad also. But now we don't advise raw fruit or raw vegetable to them. Fruit also, those which you remove the peel, those kind of fruits only you should get. And you have to sanitize, I mean, wash the fruits also in little bit of turmeric and salt, because we're just being extra careful with the geriatric people.
Steffi Devasi wants to know how we can balance PCOD through proper nutrition.
Now, this is for elders or for youngsters? Okay. If it's PCOD for youngsters, because it attacks more youngsters today because they are overweight, PCOD, basically you need to meet a doctor and a dietitian. Whatever you need to take medically, you have to do. And for overweight and PCOD, we will give you lot of vegetables, which today the girls or boys, they don't like it. So the girls specifically, because it is PCOD, please have lot of vegetables and remember the colors, more like the rainbow, more variety. And have, you know, the what happens is people, when mothers come with PCOD children, they tell us, you know, my daughter doesn't like vegetables. This is not something to be proud of about. I'm very ruthless. You have to eat vegetables. If they have not allowed the child to be part of the system, they have to start being part of the system in cutting vegetables, and after the pandemic goes out, in buying vegetables and to be part of the system. Then automatically everybody will start eating vegetables. And what are the vegetables? The green leafy vegetables, the beans variety, we have five types, all the goats, we have 8 to 12 types, and then comes the traditional vegetables. Every 100 kilometers of this country has a different set of vegetables. So start using seasonal vegetables. People have forgotten that there are seasonal vegetables because they buy in the AC market. They don't go to the mandis. So once the pandemic moves out, go back to the old way of life, buying in the local shops, which will give you the seasonal vegetables. We have the highest biodiversity of vegetables. But when the demonetization happened, we took permission and we went to find out what are the vegetables people are eating. We find it's potato, potato, potato. Then there's a little bit of tomato. There's a little bit of cauliflower, cabbage, and that's it. Maybe carrots here and there. What is the huge biodiversity? Green leafy vegetable, we have 16 varieties. If I start going on, we have 60 to 80 varieties of vegetables and we use 3 or 4. Please start expanding that, PCOS will be out of the window.
Eat food after using hand sanitizer.
Not at all. Please wash hands where you can. If you can't wash hands, that's the option. Always hand sanitizer, they have said, is best when you don't have an option to wash with water. But if you have an option to wash with soap and water, that's the best. Okay.
Rashmi Bijukumar asks, is it safe to keep hand sanitizer inside scooter or two-wheelers?
That's fine. It's okay. I don't think it's so much of a problem because it's sealed and well kept, unless you're pouring it out into bottles which are empty and things like that. And don't take large amounts, take small amounts. That's all. Yeah.
Yeah. Nicholas wants to know, my mother of 64 years old takes a blended ginger and lemon juice every night to boost her immunity for COVID. Is there any complication to her in future?
If she's not acidic, it's fine. But otherwise, ginger is preferred to have, you know, for geriatric people during the daytime rather than the night. She can repeat that after her breakfast, maybe at 11 o'clock or something, or early morning if she's not acidic, right? But otherwise, it shouldn't lead to any problem.
Aishwarya Girijan wants to know whether we can recommend non-veg foods for geriatric COVID patients.
Absolutely. You can give chicken or fish cooked very well because the protein helps them. That's all. Everybody is worried about the chicken, whether the COVID will come from the chicken. We in our country luckily don't have raw foods. Raw non-veg we don't eat. So we are safe. So cook it well. And chicken anyway, we remove the skin and all that. We don't even use it with the skin. So chicken, fish and eggs are fine. Cook them well, there's no problem.
Sainava S. Asks, how can we balance protein urea through proper nutrition?
See, when protein urea is happening, you need extra protein actually. That's why I said, when you spoke about renal, for certain types like glomerulonephritis or when there's proteinuria, actually we have to give more protein to them. But when they have chronic renal failure, we have to watch out for the quantity of protein they are eating. So it's very important that they eat a little more protein, and if they are not able to use it through foods itself, then you add the supplements. There's no other way to do it.
Thank you, ma'am. I think we had enough discussion. And thank you, ma'am, so much for your valuable time and sharing your thoughts.
Thanks so much. Bye-bye.
Participants, please note, the feedback form will be posted in the group now. I request the participants to fill their feedback form to receive your e-certificates. I repeat, participants have to fill their feedback form to receive their e-certificates. May I now call upon Dr. Seeja Thomachin, Head of Department Community Science, College of Horticulture, Kerala Agriculture University, whose untiring efforts are behind this program, to to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sharon. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
A very good afternoon to all. Honorable Vice Chancellor, respected Associate Dean, our most valued invited speakers, my colleagues and dear participants. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for this national webinar. I, on behalf of the Department of Community Science, extend a very hearty thanks to the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. R. Chandra Babu, for inaugurating the webinar. We are really thankful for your support, sir. A lot of gratitude and respect for our distinguished guest speakers for sparing their valuable time to grace this occasion, and also for enlightening us with their commendable talk on the subject. All speakers have put best of their efforts to make this event memorable. At the outset, I thank Dr. Umesh Kapil for delivering the keynote address and throwing light to the impact of current COVID pandemic in elderly. We are really enlightened with your knowledge and presence. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation to Dr. Suresh Kumar for enlightening us with challenges for well-being of geriatric population as well as the specific issues at the time of COVID. I'm also very grateful to Dr. Dharani Krishnan for the very informative and useful talk on how to make the geriatric eat the right. Thank you, Madam. I would like to take this opportunity to place on record our hearty thanks to our Associate Dean, Dr. C. Narayanankutty, for the perfect logistic support and guidance extended to us for the smooth conduct of the webinar. Also, I would like to extend a special thanks to Dr. Shaji M., Assistant Professor, College of Forestry, Sri Aravind, Sri Harijit, Srimadi Shiba, and Sri Anish for their support and technical guidance. An event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheels start rolling weeks ago. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of very motivated and dedicated students from our Community Science Department. I take this opportunity to thank all the students from the department with special mention to Remyamul, Simla, Regisha, and Nivya. I also extend my sincere thanks to my colleagues, Dr. Anina, Dr. Sharon, who was a moderator of this webinar, and Dr. Lakshmi Pierce for their enormous cooperation in the organization of this event. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants for showing their interest in the program and also for their active participation. I once again thank everyone for making this event successful with your contribution. Thank you all. Deep from my heart, I thank everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Seja. With that, we have come to the close of today's program. May I now make the most of the moment by thanking everyone for your support in making this program a success. Thank you.